Here Shiva is giving you the technique. Straight away is introducing the techniques. These great sutras are delivered to Devi Parashakti. You need to understand whoever enters into the same attitude or the mood of Devi, only they can receive the sutras. Completely receptive, fully open. One more reason why Shiva is not giving introduction, because he is speaking to Devi. Devi does not need any logical introduction. See, all philosophy is just to prove the superiority of the person who is speaking. Let it be very clear. All philosophies. That is why so many philosophies. No two philosophers will say the same thing, because he can't have his individuality. He has to change the world. He has to create some problem. Buddha's Nirvana, Shankara's Apurna, both are one and the same if you experience. But philosophers will never have it. If you unite, philosophers will not have any job. Philosophers can't have job if people can be so. It is their job. Small story. One philosopher and a doctor and engineer, all three of them were sitting and discussing. Suddenly the conversation turned to the topic, whose profession is oldest? Doctor started claiming, see, God to rip out Adam and created Eve, means God is the doctor. So doctor profession is the oldest profession. Engineer said, no, before that God created the world, he is a creator, engineer. My profession is the oldest profession. Philosopher said, fools, read the Bible. You can't read the first line. Before everything, there was chaos. Who created that? Who else can create that? Only philosopher can create. So my profession was much older than that. Be very clear, philosophy is nothing but expression of egos. Somebody asked, Mamaji, if he is calling for debate, will you go? The other day, one journalist. Journalists, they know how to create problems. And I said, first thing, through this debate, we can't prove whether God exists or not. We can only find out who has got more sharp logic. Either me or him, that's all. We can't prove by our debate whether God exists or not. Neither I represent the group which believes in God, nor he will be able to represent the group which believes there is no God. At the most, we can find out between us who has got sharp logic. Who can manage, who can shout? Who can shout for a long time? Who can withstand? Who can use more words? Whose logic is more sharp? If you are married, you will understand. If you are married, you will understand. It's nothing but who can stand for a long time and say the same nonsense. That's all. If you can stand for a long time and say the same thing in the same pitch without losing your confidence, that's all, nothing else. So the philosophy or logical debates can't bring the truth out. It can only bring one thing. Who can stand for a long time? Who can shout for a long time? Who has not enough of vengeance, the aggressiveness to withstand? Who doesn't get tired? Understand? That is why in those days, in debates, they don't decide the truth based on the arguments. They decide the truth based on the conscious development of the individual. From which consciousness those words are coming out? What is the mental setup? What is the mental condition of the person who is sitting and talking about the philosophy, talking about the truth? If you know the story of Mandana Mishra and Shankara, you will understand what I am saying. When Mandana Mishra and Shankara started arguing about the truth, both of them are open, both of them are ready to do research and development. Understand, I can't even use the word argument. I can only say sharing the notes. It was comparing and sharing the notes. Because the judge is Mandana Mishra's boy. If it was an argument out of arrogance or out of hatred or enmity, I don't think Shankara would have trusted Mandana Mishra's wife to be judge. Mandana Mishra's wife sitting as a judge shows that whole scene was a very intimate, friendly atmosphere. It was a beautiful ambience. It was more like a discussion. Shankara is ready to listen to Mandana Mishra, and if Mandana Mishra, what Mandana Mishra expresses, if that is going to be the truth, Shankara is ready to follow Mandana Mishra's path. And saying that Mandana Mishra is ready to follow Shankara's path if he understands the truth in a much deeper way through Shankara. It was a very beautiful atmosphere. That is why Mandana Mishra's wife was judge. She was judge. And she is such an intelligent lady. She says, truth cannot be understood by argument. It can be only judged by the quality of your consciousness, not based on the words which you express. I can judge only based on the quality of your consciousness. Then she creates a beautiful technique to find out whose consciousness is peaceful, pleasant, friendly and loving. She says, we will make a garland, two garlands made of the same kind of flowers, and we will offer to both of them. Both of them will start arguing. If somebody whose garlands withers away first, he will be a failure. You may understand. You may think, how can this experiment show about the quality of consciousness? If you look little deep, you will understand. Whenever you argue, whenever you are aggressive, your body temperature will increase. The heat in the body will increase. Naturally, the flowers will wither. The flowers will wither. If you are not aggressive, if you are peaceful, if you are calm, if you are centered in your inner space, if you are conscious of what you are doing, naturally the flowers will be fresh. Because your body is maintaining the temperature. It's not going to become hot. It's not going to radiate the restlessness. That was the reason why she created this technique. And naturally, when the Mandanamishra's daughter became black and Mandanamishra's garland, and the Mandanamishra's garland flowers are withered away, she declared, "You are defeated because you are not speaking out of your experience. You are speaking just to prove your identity. Understand, if you speak the truth, you will never lose your self-centered coolness. You will never lose your calmness. If you are speaking for some reason, if you are speaking for some vested interest, you will be restless, you will be aggressive, you will torture the text, you will bend the truth to establish your identity." Here, Shankara is totally calm, centered. He is not bothered about establishing his identity. He is bothered about further research. He is a seeker. All enlightened masters will be sincere seekers. Let me be very clear. They will be the seekers. They will be seekers. They will bother only about the truth. They will not bother about establishing identity. Here, if you are not bothered about establishing the identity, naturally you will be centered. You will be calm. You will be cool. You will be collected. Your body will not radiate heat. You will not be restless. The moment Sharada is the name of Mandanamishra's wife. The moment Sharada felt Mandanamishra is restless, he is aggressive, she understood what he is speaking is not from his experience. He is using the words just to establish his identity. Let me be very clear, all philosophers who does not have experience within their being will be aggressive, restless, using words to establish their identity. Practically every philosophy is created just to establish their identity. It is business for them. Let you not miss your seeking or search in somebody else's business. Those days in our Vedic culture, whether you are sick or not, whether you use the doctor or not, you have to give the share which belongs to him. Actually, that's a wonderful system. So that he will not expect you to fall sick. Understand? If your body is somebody's income source, naturally what he has to do? Naturally he has to design more and more things to work on your body. Understand the practical condition. Your body is income source for somebody. And naturally what he has to do? If he is little intelligent, he will design methods and techniques to make you come to him again and again. If he is not that much intelligent, at least he will pray to God that I should get more and more patients. If he is intelligent, he will do something in the outer world. If he is not that much courageous or intelligent, he will at least do something in the inner world. Create the path, create the path pattern to have more and more patience. The Vedic system, whether you use the doctor or not, you have to pay. That's a wonderful system. Naturally, he will not expect you to fall sick. Because if he falls sick, he has to work more. Otherwise, he can just add his salary and sit in job. Anyhow, just like how your body is the income source for doctors, your mind is the income source for philosophers. More people are convinced by his philosophy, more his ego gets established, more he feels strengthened. have seen many aggressive creatures who have not experienced by themselves. Many of them come to me because the deep guilt, sometimes you really start seeking healing master. They come to me. In private they confess, Swamiji, I only speak, I do not know the truth. Please teach me something, tell me something. I tell them, what, then why do you preach so aggressively? They say, only when we see many people following us, we feel confident about the theories which we are speaking. Only when we see many people following us, we feel confident about the theories which we are teaching. Really, one teacher told me, very openly, told me, Swamiji, in the beginning when I started teaching, I did not have confidence. Now I think when 10,000 people are following me, how can I be fooled? Now I start having really confidence over my intelligence. Be very clear. Just like how your body is income source for doctors, the people now in the medical field, of course, in India it is lot less. Very honestly. India is godless. Just like that, the same way, for philosophers, your mind is the income source. Let you not lose your mind going behind the empty philosophies. That is what Shiva wants to say. That is why straight away he is entering into the technique. He is not giving introduction. Let it be very clear. I have taken 30 minutes to give introduction to Shiva Sutras, but Shiva has not taken even a single word to give introduction. Of course, he is speaking to Devi and speaking to you. He can straight away say, Devi is already deeply connected. She is already in tune. That's the reason you are able to express the truth as it is. One more thing you should understand about this book. This book is not the discussion between guru and disciple. All discussions which happens between guru and disciple will always have one problem. The guru will again and again try to establish his identity. He has to again and again establish that he knows more than a disciple. Only then disciple will continue to be a disciple. Otherwise, he will say bye. Not only now, even in those days, knowledge was buyer's market. It was not seller's market. In India, it was not seller's market, it was buyer's market. Even in those days, knowledge was buyer's market. The other day, I had a chance to see some of the old records. Only in South India, in 1902, 2 lakh Vedic universities existed. 200,000 just in these 4 states. Andhra, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Kerala. 200,000 in 1902. 200,000 Vedic universities. Veda Padashalas, the Gurukulams existed. Now only 6,000. Now we have only 6,000. Anyhow, 200,000. So naturally, knowledge is buyer's market. It's not seller's market. So constantly, Guru has to establish, he knows. He has to use more words to show, he has to complicate things. So that disciple will continue to ask questions. Disciple will be constantly kept in doubts. If you explain the truth in a very simple way, naturally disciple won't have any questions. Disciple not having questions is too much. It disturbs the ego of the master. It means master is not necessary. He is not needed. Here, Shiva, the Shiva Sutras, is not discussion between guru and disciple. It's an intimate discussion between the beloved and Shiva. It's an intimate discussion between Shiva and Devi.